Good morning and welcome to Calendar Bay Church Online. I'm Pastor John Intoff and thank you so much for joining us for our online service today. Well, it was a very nice week here in Northern Ontario. I even had some flowers coming up in the front yard as spring officially seems to have sprung. We had a couple winter storms that kind of hung on at the end there, but now we seem to be finally moving into some more spring-like weather, and I am looking forward to it immensely. Thank you so much for being a part of our service today, and there's a number of ways that you can be a part of our service. Number one is you can do what you're doing presently, which is watching the service online, and you can do that a couple different ways. We have what's called our YouTube premiere, which takes place every Sunday morning at 10:30 a.m., and so you can watch the service with others and be able to interact with one another as you watch the service. After that point, it's available at any time, and so you can watch the service at your convenience. It's also other services are available, so if you missed a message in a series, you can get caught up on those as well. We also have our in-person worship service, which takes place 10:30 a.m. every Sunday morning, and so you can come. Right now, we have our kids ministry running during the service for those that are ages 5 to 12, junior church, and we also have nursery that runs on every other week. We're hoping to be able to get that up to every week, but right now we have enough volunteers to be able to offer that service every other week. The nursery will be open every week, but some weeks it will be unsupervised. So whether you enjoy the service online or in person, we appreciate you and your connection here at Calendar Bay Church. Updates. If you want to be updated on what's going on here at Calendar Bay Church, there's a few ways that you can do that. Probably the best way is to go to our webpage, calendarbaychurch.ca, and the bulletin is available there every week, and so you can just take a look at it there. You can actually download it and print it as well, if that's what you like to do. You can also check us out on Facebook. We have a group that's on Facebook, and we post a lot of our information there. We also have a newsletter that we send out 5 days a week, just giving you some of those updates as well. So lots of things that are happening here at Calendar Bay Church, and just want to highlight a couple things. Well, number one is that this isn't particularly a Calendar Bay Church thing. I will be involved with it, but it is the KFM Share-a-thon on April 19 and 20. And so if you want to support Christian radio in North Bay and across Northern Ontario, you can tune in and call in and support Christian radio in that way. Something special that is coming up is we're bringing back the Awana Grand Prix. And so we're getting together our cars. We're going to have a great morning on Saturday, May the 13th. And so that's when that's coming. There's more details about that in our bulletin. And so you can check that out at our webpage. Thank you for your ongoing support of Calendar Bay Church. And if you would like to give to the ministry of Calendar Bay Church, there's a couple ways that you can do that. One, you can safely and securely give to the ministry of Calendar Bay Church by going to our website, calendarbaychurch.ca/give, and you can safely and securely give there. The other way is that you can mail in your gift, which you can send to our mailing address, which is Calendar Bay Church, Box 218, Calendar, Ontario, P0H1H0. That's Calendar Bay Church, Box 218, Calendar, Ontario, P0H1H0. Well, we want to worship the Lord together, and this is a great song which reminds us of the greatness of God. Our God is greater, and now let's sing it together.
Open the eyes of the blind.
One thing that we know living in North America is that we have lots of choices. If you go to a grocery store and you head down the cereal aisle, you are hit with a myriad of choices of, you know, whether you're going to have bran flakes or Alphabets or Honeycomb or Vector or some other kind of cereal. There are tons of different choices. Now, the problem with most of choices in North America is that you're not choosing between good and bad. Now, there are those decisions in life that are more, that was an easy decision. That's a bad choice. And so I'm not going to do that. I'm going to choose something else instead. Most of the decisions that we make in North America are not choosing between good and bad. They're choosing between what's good and what's better. And the Bible actually uses the phrase better on a number of occasions. And the Bible encourages us, and this is the series of messages that we're going to be looking at over the next number of weeks, is how do we choose better? Because there are a myriad of options that we have, and God doesn't want us to just merely settle on the good. He wants us to choose the better. And so we want to take a look at some of the better scriptures that are out there. That sounds kind of funny. They're all good scriptures, all scriptures God breathed. But there are some that include the word better. And we can learn a lot about looking at what God deems to be the better choice. The first one that we want to look at today is found in Psalm 84. And so we're going to look at a few verses of Psalm 84, and this is how it starts off in verses 1 and 2. How lovely is your dwelling place, Lord Almighty. My soul yearns, even faints, for the courts of the Lord. My heart and my flesh cry out for the living God. And then it goes on, and this is what David, who wrote Psalm 84, says. He says in verse 10, better is one day in your courts than 1,000 elsewhere. I would rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than dwell in the tents of the wicked. So there's the phrase. Better is one day in God's courts than 1,000 elsewhere. The scripture tells us that the better choice is to dwell in the house of the Lord. And so the psalmist is basically coming to this conclusion. It's saying a day with God is better than a day not with God. And so the better choice is if you're going to choose what you're doing with your day, it's better to do it with God than it is to do it apart from God. And the scripture actually goes on and it says that the lowest position, he actually talks about a doorkeeper, which, the bouncer, the guy who stands by the door, is not the top position. It's not I just want to be a doorkeeper. A doorkeeper was kind of on the lower end of the totem pole. And he says that the lowest position in God's presence tops anything that the world can offer. So any position that the world offers, being the worst position in God's presence is way better than any other options that are out there. And so if you're to choose better, it's better to be in God's presence. It's better to even be the worst position in God's presence than it is to be anywhere else. Now, there's some confusion that comes along with that. Because the confusion is, most of us, I don't think we truly believe that. Do we really truly believe that it is better one day in God's courts is better than 1,000? The 1,000 is basically, when you do the math, 365 in a year. It's basically about 3 years. So it says one day in God's presence is better than 3 years any other place. Any other place. Now start thinking about that. What are some of those any other places? It says better is one day in God's presence than 3 years in Hawaii. Think about that. Or 3 years doing, think of the best activities that you can possibly think of. 3 years of hanging out at the mall. For some of you, you're saying, that's not a really good thing. For some people, they like to hang out there. Maybe not as much as it used to be. But the scripture tells us that it's better to be one day in God's presence than 3 years anywhere else. And I think in North America, the way we live reveals that we truly don't believe that. I don't know if I see a lot of people kind of clamoring to be in God's presence instead of doing other activities. Even in my own life, you know, I see that a lot of times my preferences reveal. Like, you know, I could watch sports for hours. I can do it. I have done it. I continue to probably watch a lot of sports. And I have to think about that. What is my life revealing about what I truly think is better? And oftentimes it reveals that my better, I think of many other activities before I think of being in God's presence. You know, the claim of Scripture says this. Now, this is a kind of an interesting transition that we make as we kind of move out of, this is from the Psalm 84 is in the Old Testament. And so when he's talking about being in the courts of God, generally he's talking about being in the temple and that he loves being in where God's presence was, which was in the physical temple. Now, as we move into the New Testament, there's an interesting transition that begins to take place. And it says that we have become post-cross resurrection and the coming of the Holy Spirit, we have become the temple where God resides, that God's kingdom now resides in us, that God by his Spirit resides in us. And so the same as God's was in the temple, now he is in us. And so this is what it says in 1 Corinthians 3:16. It says that, don't you know that you yourselves are God's temple and that God's Spirit dwells in your midst? And so the scripture teaches us that you are God's temple. So when it talks about the fact that we have the ability to be in his presence, that's all the time that we have that access. That access is all the time because God is residing in us by his Spirit. And so as we look at this, we actually have within us the capability to actively live in the presence of God all the time. Which when we go jump back to what the conclusion or the confusion shows us that maybe we're not tapping into that reality as much as we should be. Because the claim is that, and the scripture goes on in Psalm 63:1, he says, because your love is better than life, my lips will glorify you. Scripture reveals God is residing in us and that his love is better than life itself. Anything that life offers. So if you go through all the different options in life, his love is better than all those different options. So David is saying God's presence is the number one place to be. Another place, God's love is better than anything that life offers. All the different options and choices, God's love is the best option. That there's nothing better than his love. And it goes on and it says that in Isaiah 55:9, it says, as the high heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways and my thoughts than your thoughts. And so what the scripture is telling us is that not only is his presence the best, not only is his love the best, that God's way is better than any other option that's out there. So when we start looking at plans and future and those type of things, there is nothing better than God's. Get his stuff is way higher, it's way better, it's way gooder than anything else that's out there on the option list. And because of that, we can experience what I call daily better. Daily better is offered to each one of us. We have the possibility of his daily provision. We have the possibility of his daily protection. We have the guarantee, I guess, of his presence. And we also have his peace. The question we have to ask is, how do we have a day with God? If it's better a day in God's presence than a thousand elsewhere, well then how do we do that? Is that a possibility for us, or is that just something that's not even remotely attainable in North American society? So how do we do that? Oftentimes when we think about it, we often think, well, you know, we must have to do and pray and Bible study. And those things are good, and they'll be a part of it. But we can't, you know, just merely shut off the rest of the world. How do we do this? How can we live with an ongoing, unending awareness of God's presence? And is that even possible? Can we live in such a way that we experience his ongoing, unending awareness? And this morning I want to give us three habits, and then maybe I'm going to throw in something, a bonus as well. Three habits that I think will help us if we want to choose the better in this situation. And so the three habits are, number one, developing the habit of constant communication with God. The scripture does encourages us to, in 1 Thessalonians 5:17, to pray continually. And so we need to try to figure out, how do we do that on a daily basis? You know, I think that there's some great examples from Scripture. I love the story of Nehemiah. And Nehemiah is going to plead his case to the king so that he can rebuild the walls of Jerusalem. And as he's going into the meeting, he's just praying under his breath, God, help me to be able to represent you well to the king and doing that. And so he just breathes a prayer as he's going, and then he goes and does what he needs to do. And then afterwards, he's praying again and asking for God's assistance. Nehemiah was a story of a guy who was administratively minded, you know, and organized and was taking on this gigantic project. But he was also a person who was committed to an ongoing praying existence. And so we need to begin to develop the habit of constantly being in that attitude of prayer. And part of that comes from just thinking about God and how God would interact in our present circumstances, and then seeking to bring that to him in the midst of that. Some people are better at this. For me, I'm a little bit of a, what I would call an ADD prayer. You know, it's like, dear God, squirrel, you know, and then I'm off in a million different directions. And so for some of us, this is going to be a little bit harder. But I don't think it gives us the excuse that we can't do this, that we need to constantly be looking and at our life and our circumstance and bringing those things to God. And so we need to be in an attitude of constant prayer, because if Scripture is true, and we do believe that, we are aware of the fact that God is residing in us, and so we have this ability to be able to commune with him on a daily and regular basis in our everyday activities. And so we need to try to develop and nurture that attitude. And so as we get up in the morning, what do you need to do? You know, you start your day by inviting God's presence into your day and saying, God, I want you to order my steps as you go through your day, as you step into your vehicle, saying, God, keep me safe as I go to work. And or if you're at home, you know, God, help me to be the best I can be at home and doing the things that I need to do here. Constantly be looking for that. Look for ways of cultivating the habit of communication with God throughout the day. Have a prayer on your lips. Always be thankful. That's another way, is when, you know, just expressing God your thanksgiving and his praise for who he is. All sorts of different ways that we can do that. So the first habit is that we need to develop the habit of constant communication. The second habit is instant obedience to God. This is what it says in Galatians 5:25. Since we live by the Spirit, let us keep in step with the Spirit. We want to be keeping in step with the Spirit. If we're in a constant state of communication, we should be more in tune with what it is that God wants us to do. And so we want to try to develop the habit of instantly being obedient to him whenever he speaks to us, because the Scripture encourages us to keep in step with the Spirit. Whenever I hear of keeping in step, I'm reminded of an activity that we used to do as kids. I think we've done it here in Awana too. Is a three-legged race. Now, the three-legged race is one of the funniest things to watch, because you get two individuals and then you tie their legs together, and then they have to race around a circle together. Now, the interesting thing about it is those that are able to get in sync with each other are able to move quite fluidly around the circle. But there are others that they keep trying to do it by themselves, and they get out of step, they fall down. And this reminds me of the life of the Spirit. I am to strap or tether myself to God, and then God moves, and I'm supposed to keep step with him. It's not about me going, hey, let's go over here, God. Let's do this. It's me keeping in step with, I'm going off the camera there, keeping in step with him, because I need to be about what my Father's business. You know, we talked about that earlier. I need to be about my Father's business. And how am I to be about? I am to keep step with what he is trying to accomplish. And so I am to try to develop that instant obedience. And so if God says move, I'm able to keep step with him. Because the more that I say no and the more I chafe, the more problems. Because, you know, I've had to untangle some kids that have, you know, that they just were pulling against, and then you had to come in and you had to rescue them. And you know, and other times they would try to carry each other, and it would keep in step. And we do this by learning instant obedience. Every day God is going to give you small opportunities to be attentive and attuned to his voice, and he's looking for those individuals that are in tune with him and are obedient to him. I always find this interesting, that there seems to be those people that God uses more miraculously, and God seems to speak to them more. You know, and the reason I have discovered is that they were yes people to God. They said yes to God, and God continues to give them opportunities. For those of us who say no, we're just getting dragged by our foot, you know, trying because we aren't keeping in step with the Spirit. We miss the opportunities. And the third habit is that there needs to be a daily desperation for God. This is what it says. There needs to be this daily desperation for God. Psalm 84:2, the early part of Psalm 84, says that my soul yearns, even faints for the Lord. God wants us to be as desperate for him as we are for, you know, a deer pants for water. You know, that there needs to be this desperation. I once heard of a story of this guy who was wanting to seek God, and went to this spiritually wise person, and he says, well, you know, why can't I seem to be able to find God? And now I don't recommend this. This is not, but it's a good story. This is the guy was sitting beside a stream, and the spiritual guy came and pushed his head under the water and held him under the water. And the guy was struggling under this, and he finally conceded to that he was gonna, that this guy was going to kill him for some reason. Anyway, and then he let him up again, and then the spiritual guy says, when you long for God as deeply as you did for your breath, that's when you'll find him. And God wants us to seek him desperately. Because ultimately, when you look at it, he gives us everything we need. He is our life. He's our breath. He's everything. And so God wants us to desperately seek him. Because many times, what do? We desperately seek other things. And the question, why don't we desperately? Because oftentimes, we look for fulfillment in other things. And the scripture says that God is to be the person or the place where all our fountains are, that the source of everything that we have. And so God wants us to desperately seek him. Like there is no other options, because there isn't. David says, better is one day in your presence than 1,000 elsewhere. And let me just give you one more thing. Sometimes I think God wants us to do a little bit extra. You know, I think he wants us to daily live for him, like those three suggestions. Those were all daily things. Being desperate for him. Being, trying to be obedient to his voice. And trying to seek him with all of our hearts. And doing those things. Cultivating that habit of daily being with him. But sometimes he asks us to go a little bit further. You know, the scripture points out that when he was establishing the rules of living, he gave us 10 commandments, and the one was about the Sabbath principle. And we've talked a little recently about these things, that God is interested in us setting aside a day in order to be able to seek him more fully. And he wants us to focus on worship and rest and to rest in him. So God wants us to be able to do that. And so God may want us to step a little bit out of our regular routine and to seek him a little bit more fully. Maybe he's calling you to take an extra walk and commune with him more. Maybe he's calling you to read your word more deeply. Maybe he's calling you to really follow the Sabbath principle and to be able to set aside one day per week where you just don't do work. All you do is focus on God and you focus on rest. That's all you do. God wants us to daily cultivate the habit of being in communion with him, because scripture tells us that it's better to have that one day than 1,000 elsewhere. But sometimes God wants us to go a little bit further. Sometimes we become very content where we are on our spiritual journey, or maybe we're not content, but we become kind of apathetic in that position. And the scripture tells us that we need to seek him with all our heart. Because the scripture tells us, as we go through life and we're making choices, that the better choice is one day in the house of God than 1,000 elsewhere. And as we go through life, we need to choose better. There are a myriad of options which are vying for your daily attention. And scripture tells us, better is one day in his courts than 1,000 elsewhere. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you've made this even a possibility. This is truly amazing that because we are the temple of the Holy Spirit and you live and abide with us, that we have the option to daily commune with you and daily be in your presence. God, help us to cultivate that, because better is that time in your presence than anything else that we can find. And so God, we pray that you would help us to be able to apply these things into our lives. Help us to be able to choose the better. For we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, we want to sing. Now, this is a song based on that scripture. It's better is one day. And let's just make this our prayer that we would be choose the better. And as we sing this song, let's decide to do that in our hearts. Better is one day in your courts than 1,000 elsewhere. Let's sing. Thanks so much for being a part of our online service today. We pray that God would richly bless you. And let's make sure that as we go through this week, let's choose the better. Let's choose God's presence over all the other options that are out there. Let's make sure we choose Him first. Again, I hope that you have a wonderful week, and we'll see you all next week again as we look at more things that God wants us to choose the better. See you next week.
Better is one.